Hi, I'm Jeff King. I'm an executive producer of the Umbrella Academy, and I'm here to moderate the Academy of Television Arts and Sciences panel. Here with me now are the stars of the Umbrella Academy, Elliot Page, who plays Vanya Hargreaves, Tom Hopper, who stars as Luther Hargreaves, David Castañeda, who stars as Diego Hargreaves, Emmy Raver-Lampman, who stars as Allison Hargreaves, Robert Sheehan, who plays Klaus Hargreaves, Aidan Gallagher, who plays Five, and Justin H. Min, who stars as Ben Hargreaves. Thank you for being here on your weekends. We're in the middle of shooting Umbrella Academy Season 3, but we're going to talk about Umbrella Academy Season 2. And I'm going to start with Elliot. We find your character in a vulnerable place when Season 2 begins, yearning to know your past, freedom to make your future. Were you surprised by any of those arcs, and how did your character develop over Season 2?
Gosh, well, I feel like I was surprised often, because one of the delightful things about making the show is as we read the scripts, you know, a lot of things are unknown to us. So I feel like there's always delightful surprises. In terms of the arc, yeah, I suppose there was an accumulation of surprises in terms of her journey in the second season. We find her at the beginning, and she is so vulnerable in some ways, but also she's let go of so much baggage. Wasn't great for the world, she destroyed the moon, but it sort of gives her this opportunity to discover so much about herself, and she falls in love for the first time, and eventually when she is reconnected to her memories, there's a lot of shame and upheaval, but ultimately Vanya's arc has a lot to do with really coming to terms with who she is in her past and figuring out how to move forward with all of that.
Fantastic. Talk about working with Marin Ireland.
Yeah, I mean, Marin Ireland is just so superb. And I think just immediately we connected and connected with these roles and trusted each other. And I think approach work in a similar way. So just as actors, I feel like we really had an energy together that worked. Yeah, it was really an amazing experience to get to do this with her.
Tom, Luther this season has a bit of a devil-may-care attitude towards his family responsibilities. What was it like taking that shift in the character? How did that influence how you played him?
Yeah, I mean, I think Luther in the first season is so extreme with his leadership and the want to be the leader and the want to take control. And ultimately, this shift in the second season, I suppose, is the first time that Luther has ever been himself outside of the Academy. It's the first time he's ever existed outside of being number one. Initially, that was probably like quite a scary thing for him. But when he starts to work with Jack Ruby, he realizes what the real world is. And actually, the world he had as with the Umbrella Academy was not real. You know, that was something that was fabricated, I think, for him. And he starts to realize who he really is inside. And that was a really nice shift for me, because like you say, that devil may care kind of attitude, I think it kind of carries through through the whole season. And he starts to, you know, you see the bit with Hargreaves in when he really rips his shirt open. All these little shifts for Luther of him dealing with those issues. They'll always be there. They're always underlying for him. But it's quite a nice cathartic season for him, I think, to deal with that and let go of being number one.
You talked about that scene with Hargreaves playing with Comfior and confronting your father for the first time.
Yeah.
That was impressive, to say the least. Pretty crazy family meeting. How is that for you to be with all your siblings again after having been apart for so long?
Yeah, I mean, it's the thing is with this show, like, I mean, I think we all agree with this, that it's so much fun to do. And I think the most fun we have is when we do big scenes all together. You know, we really play off each other, and we're very fortunate that we get a lot of room to play, you know, and discover as we're working. So in that scene itself took like 3-4 days to shoot, I think, that tiki bar scene. So we were covered in pineapple about 15 times over. But it goes throughout, you know, the show with all the family scenes, they're always a joy to do, really.
David, this season, the audience sees a softer side, a more vulnerable side to Diego. What do you think brought that on?
I think it's because they got to know me. You know what I mean? You know, I think the writing. I'm sure sometimes, you know, you kind of, just being tough can get really boring. And, you know, it's not really relatable. And how do you you know, make people connect to any story. It's like you gotta see defects and problems that are very common and human. And obviously Diego trying to, you know, find an acceptance with his father. But now it's kind of shown through JFK and the introduction of Lila Pitts and his ability to like see someone else and their own insecurities and feel like, oh, you understand me. And being able to confront Dad in the tiki scene, I feel like the writers did a really wonderful job in like fleshing out, not just my character, but I think everyone's kind of storyline and giving the audience already, you know, they're already kind of attached to our characters. So therefore, it's a lot of more room to play.
I think any of us who has somebody in our life who has that kind of power over us, like Hargreaves has over this family, understands that moment and how humbling and how hard those can be and how you hope they go another way and then they don't.
I related to my own father, you know? It's very, I think anyone can.
Emmy.
Yes, Jeff.
Allison, forced to be reckoned with this season. She's not only a powerful female, but she's also an important figure in the civil rights movement in the 60s. How did that inform your approach to play her?
Taking on the civil rights movement as an actress, as a woman of color, and as a show, it was something that it was really important to me that it was dealt with delicately and with respect and not something that was glossed over or not taken seriously. And I personally did so much research and read so many books and movies and documentaries and really kind of tried to submerge myself in a deeper understanding of that time. But I think the unfortunate part is that a lot of people like to think that that was a really long time ago and that time is separate from today. It actually was a lot easier than I thought to come to terms with and understand what it could possibly have been like for Allison, because I experience systemic racism every day, and so do so many Americans, and so do so many people of color and marginalized people. And, you know, Ruby Bridges, the first Black child to integrate an all-white school, is in her 60s. She's younger than my mom. It's not a distant past. It's actually really, really close. And the issues of the civil rights and the struggles of the civil rights and the fight of the civil rights movement are still being waged today. And that was something that someone like Congressman Lewis spent his entire life's work dedicated to making change and forward progression for inclusion and diversity. And we just lost him last year. And if, you know, 2020 was a huge struggle in so many ways with the pandemic, with social injustice, and with Black Lives Matter. And I think the show coming out when it did and Allison's storyline being what it was, I think there's a sense of poetic parallel there, I think. But I think if anything, what people can walk away from this Allison story this season is that she may have been in the 60s, but what she was fighting for and the lessons that she was learning and the changes that needed to be made then still need to be made today.
Mm-hmm. So often we see those pictures in black and white and those people that we talk about in those times and in those movements, and it does make it feel so far in the past, but it really isn't.
Yep. It's happening right now. Voter suppression, yeah. It's unfortunate, but I think it's hopefully just bringing the distance between these seemingly two very, very far apart time periods into a realization that the fight's not done and there's still so much work to be done.
I think we all felt that. Switching gears to Robert Klaus this season. When the season opens, we find him on the road. We find that he's become a cult leader. What was it like for you having such a transformation from season one to season two?
Well, myself and Steve Blackman, we kicked around the idea of Klaus being some sort of cult leader going into the second season, and sort of the cult. The cult's function, I suppose, in the Klaus story is ultimately so Ben can kind of end up wearing me like a prophylactic.
It seemed like some of that was connected to Dave, the soldier that he meets in Vietnam in season one.
Yeah, because I suppose if you're someone who's desperately in need of people to follow you, if you're an insecure person who can't be alone with themselves, you know, you either take drugs or you start a cult. And the drugs nearly killed Klaus, so he went on to do a cult instead. So the cult is sort of like a substitute for the drugs to kind of mask the pain that he feels, the loss of Dave, who was probably the only person he's ever loved more than himself.
Yeah.
You know? And that's including all you Muppets.
Aidan, you said before that this season audiences really get to see the humanity in Five. What did you mean by that?
Well, I think to a certain extent, Five hasn't had really a lot of time to figure out who he is. He's just been shoved through trauma his whole life, just by factor of needing to survive. And so spending time with the family, for him, it's been like 2 weeks. They really bring out a side of him which he doesn't really give to other people. So even though the world's falling apart and there are all of these little mini fires and crises that are either mentally or just what's happening around him, when we have these slower scenes with other characters, these little mini runs that he might go on, these groupings, he has a moment to sort of decompress and try and figure out a little bit more of who he is and his place in the world and bond with the other siblings.
And Dolores, let's not forget Dolores.
Do you think that because he spent so much time alone in the apocalypse to now all of a sudden be surrounded by family, he has to start over again?
For sure. I mean, he hasn't even really started. Dolores was, for him, it was his little virtual version of that. For him, it was very much an emotional and psychological crutch to sort of help him get through. Because if he could create his own little manageable insanity, it was at least something that he could control. In a world where there is so much out of control, he jumps forward, he can't get back, everything's dead and burning around him for years and years and years. That little piece of control that he could create and the mission to get through, get back to his family, survive, try and prevent this hell from ever happening, that is, I think, one of the only reasons why he made it through all of that, whether it's the apocalypse or the years working at the commission as an assassin. All of the trauma, even though he does have certain insane, sadistic parts of him which he's trying to fight and push down, all of that trauma does really wear on him. So I think it was very important for him to get to spend time with family to figure out who he is, who he wants to be, and try and carve out some semblance of a normal life.
Family definitely teaches us a lot about who we are, it's true. Justin, towards the end of the season, we see Ben finally get to connect with a sibling other than Klaus, and he has a beautiful and emotional scene with Vanya. Talk about that a little bit.
It was incredibly emotional. I remember when I first read it in the script, I started to sob, and then I immediately texted Steve Blackman and said, this is incredible and sad and heartbreaking. And I was also a bit scared because I realized the stakes in that scene. And obviously I had spent 2 seasons, you know, with this guy. And
grateful.
And you know, you develop a rhythm with an actor, and you know, I felt so comfortable with Robbie, and this was my first time acting with someone else and Elliot. So a lot of those emotions, you know, came into play on the day. And I remember when we had a rehearsal, you could hear just a pin drop in that room. It was just so quiet. And I was thankful that, like, everyone recognized what a heartfelt moment this was for these two characters. Also, fun fact, we hadn't received the last few pages of episode 10 yet, so I actually thought this was my last scene of the show. So I really was saying goodbye to Vanya as a character, but I was saying goodbye to the show and this experience. And so there was just a lot of emotions that day. But what a beautiful moment to have with Elliot and with Vanya. And I feel like those two characters really understand each other because they both know what it means to feel forgotten and ignored by their family. So I couldn't have asked for anything more.
You are so right. The crew, to a person, said when they read that script, because they hadn't got episode 10, don't let Ben die! There's literally an outpouring of that kind of love.
Yeah, and it's funny that well, I guess it's not funny. It's sad that we can't hug each other anymore. So that hug just means so much more in retrospect with everything that has happened in our world, yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna ask Elliot something. In season two, your character has so many powerful moments. What was your most memorable, small, intimate one, and what's the most memorable, big, loud action moment?
Gosh, that's always so hard, you know, because different ones are for different. I'd say there's two super impactful emotional moments, which would, of course, be what Justin was just speaking to, and A, how beautiful and meaningful it was, Ben's support in that scene and in that moment when Vanya really is just completely falling apart and just riddled with shame and self-loathing and all the memories of her trauma as well. And then also the scene saying goodbye to Sissy at the end was just like, oh, so sad and heartbreaking. And then gosh, yeah, I got to do so much more action in season two. It was so fun. I really enjoyed shooting the chase sequence in the cornfield.
Yeah.
That was
incredible.
That was a really a fun night with, you know, just crazy technology and all the magic that all the amazing crew does that I have nothing to do with, you know. So that was really fun.
I know we were all watching at the monitor, and when you turned it on running through the cornfield and the motorcycle was chasing you, that was crazy.
Crazy.
That was crazy.
Yeah.
And I think, too, just the magic of that environment and really being in a place where the corn grew from seeds and it felt very real.
Yeah.
Tom, Bare Knuckle Fighter. There were a couple of pretty amazing scenes in the ring this year. How were those to do? Were they fun? Are they hard? They look like they're a lot of fun.
They are a lot of fun. When I first read those, I mean, Steve was saying, you know, he was drawing upon like inspirations from Snatch and stuff. And there's, you know, that's one of my favorite movies. I love Snatch. I think there was something about honing in my inner Brad Pitt from Snatch while I was shooting those. Yeah, I mean, the biggest thing really was that I was in the full prosthetic for those fights. And that always kind of makes things a little bit more complicated because you get really hot in that thing. But I like it. At the end of those days when you finish shooting one of those fights, you really feel like you've had you've gone through a bit of a battle, you know, and it's great. It's a good feeling. You sleep well that night. But those two guys who I fought, like Nevin in episode one and Robert Maillet, those guys are bigger than Luther in reality. I mean, they're big dudes.
Yeah.
I was feeling some punches through the suit. Let's put it that way, yeah. I mean, Robert is a full-on giant. He's huge. Even when you know it's choreographed, that fist coming towards you, you know, but you wanna not forget the choreography.
He looks like he could hurt you too, and I think that was a beautiful part, but such a lovely,
like the gentlest guy, yeah, like proper BFG. You know BFG, right? That's the reference that's not lost on everyone. Big friendly giant, yeah, good. Yeah, you got me. Yeah, just got to say it. Roald Dahl, yeah, great book.
David, you also have some pretty incredible action this year. What goes into the making of those from beginning to end? How hard are they?
They're kind of like dancing. You know, they really are. I mean, they're properly choreographed. And Rick Forsythe, you know, who's the stunt coordinator, and, you know, Grandmaster Tommy Chang, who's the fight coordinator, they kind of come up with, like, these ideas of how we're going to do it, how everyone's going to be safe. And then they just say, go, you know, choreograph it and then see what that does. And thankfully, you know, we get a lot of freedom on, like, being like, okay, this works, it doesn't work. And the more you're prepared, the more you can kind of be improvising on set and being like, this, I can't do this, I can't do that. But when we actually shot them, I think the hallway scene was the scarier one because it was a one-er, and I had to break a vase over this man's head. And I remember looking at the stuntman before they said action, right? And his eyes, I could see this, like, you know, in like, he's like, don't hurt me, you know? I can see it in my, he was just looking at me, you know, but it was almost like this one beat of like, we got each other. You know, this is gonna be okay. Cause you know, you have to throw him through a window and pull him back. And that was a real window. And they said, Tom Verica, who was directing that episode, was like, listen, we have four windows to break. So we gotta get this in four or less. And I was just like, oh, snap.
This no pressure.
No pressure. And I was like, and I think we got it on the second take. And I kind of went to my trailer and I was just like, you know, I was doing this thing because I was like, that was the culmination of what you want out of everything. You know, you prep for so long, you know, when I was in the, you know, I was in Thailand for so long, and I was thinking, this is gonna work for something, you know, this is gonna work, and it worked for 15 seconds on frame, and I thought, okay, that played well because of preparation, and I was just really thankful for that moment.
How long was you in Thailand before we started shooting season two?
30 days, 29 days, kicking stuff. I saw this film, I was flying, I was flying to a certain country, I don't know what country it was, and I saw this film called The Prayer Before Dawn, and it was about this man stuck in a Thailand prison. And I was like, what an amazing, it was one of those films that just kind of stuck to me. And then I thought, when I heard Steve was telling me that I was gonna be stuck somewhere, I was like, I need an excuse to go to Thailand to go do those things. And I went to Thailand and, you know, stayed at a camp with other fighters, and it was quite, it was very humbling.
I think people don't really understand how much preparation you all put into all of these. Like something that lasts for 15 seconds on screen, you can be working on for weeks ahead of time. And we're doing the same thing this year too. It's a lot of commitment. Emmy.
Jeff.
The 1960s have an unmistakable aesthetic.
Yeah.
They do. What was it like going from season one and contemporary 21st century to the 60s and season two as an aesthetic?
I've always wanted to do like a period piece or a non-contemporary anything on camera. And so this was kind of like my first opportunity to dive into a time that is not our current one. It was so much more than just the clothes, from the rugs to the wallpaper to the costumes to the cars to the storefronts. I mean, we essentially rented an entire street in Hamilton, Ontario, and changed every storefront and had hundreds of 60s cars. And it was almost like a time warp when you walked onto set in Hamilton, because you just like turn the corner. There's like a 7-Eleven, and then you turn the corner and you're just like in the 60s. And for me personally, it immediately helped me kind of reset my brain to go to work on those days. But even the sets that were built, almost all of my costumes were actual vintage pieces, if not replicas, if we needed duplicates. But the shoes and then also being, you know, a woman of color, and, you know, the salon and barbershop experience is so unique to Black culture. And so, you know, having Allison working in a salon and kind of watching her progress through the hairstyles, going from her contemporary season one Allison look into the full beehive and the processed hair, and then kind of going into this straight haired 60s kind of like grassroots look. It just was really lovely to kind of experience that transition back in time. But I mean, I think we all felt like the sets and the costumes and just everything, I felt fully submerged in the 60s when I was at work.
I remember the reaction of the crew watching one of the scenes we shot early on, which is your character arriving in the alley and walking across the street and into the diner. And I know as the Steadicam snuck in behind you through those doors and spun around and saw all the reactions to you being such a fish out of water in that moment. It was incredibly powerful in the monitor. And I think that's when we all realized too how authentic it was gonna feel. And
yeah, I tried so hard that day getting on set to not look at it beforehand, because I actually wanted my like on-camera reaction to be as realistic as possible. I wanted to take it all in, because I mean, the whole street had been transformed. It was incredible, but I actually wanted to kind of take it all in for the first time.
Robert, we see a little more empathetic and connected Klaus this season. How was it to balance those heartfelt scenes against the more extravagant, happy-go-lucky Klaus that we see in season one?
I suppose I tried to look at every job as an opportunity to, you know, just in the same way that, you know, you go to a butcher for a variety of meats, you go to an actor for a variety of emotions. And you can get as many of them in there as possible. Do you know what I mean? Ideally, as tightly packed to each other as possible. So, there was plenty of room to have a play and have a fiddle with all that, yeah.
Robert Sheehan, the butcher of acting.
Yeah, the acting butcher. Watch out, Day-Lewis.
Aidan, we see Five also in a lot of action and fight sequences this year. Talk about the training process that you went through for those. Five also was involved in a big sequence with Lila early on in the season that involved a blink fight, something that we'd never done before. How was that?
It was interesting because there are a couple fight scenes which had these sort of long preparation periods of choreography. Then there are like a couple in there which were really done like maybe an hour before, which, you know, might sound chaotic out of context, but within the world of that final episode, 210, where Lila and Five are just going at it and they're starting to get a sense of what each other can do, it really worked wonders to sort of add that chaos and chaotic nature to just the way these two were fighting. Whereas some of the other ones, like, they're almost pulling their punches a little bit. There's a scene that is this sort of chase sequence between Lila and Five, where she's leading him to this abandoned warehouse. And they both are not quite giving it their all, which makes that last fight even better. Because Five understands that this is a trap, or that the handler's gonna propose something, or that something's going on. He's by this point sniffed out that she is from the commission. And she's not exactly trying to take him out. Her job is to bring him into the correct area. So there's an interesting dynamic in the fight that is more so mental than it is physical, because there's the understanding of not showing all your cards yet. So that was an interesting one to shoot, simply because there's that mental aspect. It's not purely rock'em sock'em, if you will. So that was fun.
Was it different because you're finally up against somebody who is your equal in terms of the ability?
I think we have yet to see the extent of Five and Lila in terms of fighting. They are very similar in their sort of poised cynicism and sarcasm. They're very similar characters, and so they drive each other crazy. But they kind of need each other the way that the plot is set up, so it's an interesting balance between really wanting to kill each other as the characters, but also knowing that you can't go all the way because you need the other's help. So that's a wonderful balance that's always fun to play with.
Justin, the season 2 finale introduces us to a new Ben we call Sparrow Ben. What does that mean for his relationship with the rest of the Umbrella Academy, with your siblings here? No spoilers, please.
No spoilers.
Wow.
Great.
Good luck with that. Good luck.
First of all, that scene was an absolute surprise. I mean, as I was sharing before, we had not received the last few pages of this season until I think a week before we shot that scene. I was literally like packing my bags, saying my goodbyes, and then Steve Blackman emailed just the 7 of us the final pages. And I remember just being in my Toronto apartment yelling by myself in the middle of the night. It's a different Ben. It's a very different Ben than the Ben that we know. We're getting a sense of maybe not the nicest guy, and it really sets us up for a really exciting season 3.
How weird was it to stand in this room where so many scenes have been played as a family and not to recognize your siblings while playing that moment?
It was surreal. It was surreal. I almost felt like I was on a different show. It was also surreal because I was able to make eye contact with everyone for the first time.
It was weird for us as well.
It was, yeah. I was gonna say, it was the first time I've actually, we've been in a room together in so many scenes, but like have to ignore you.
Yeah.
So it was so nice to actually
everyone
look you in the eye.
Has gotten so good on this cast, not looking at me.
Okay, let's do some rapid fires. And I'd like anybody to feel free to fire in with an answer. Favorite needle drop track of season 2?
Backstreet Boys.
Backstreet Boys. Was there a song that surprised you? Was there a song that felt either in character or out of character for the show? Was there?
I really loved the cover of Hello. I was just going to say that. When that came on, I really was just like fucking genius.
That's it. That was in a different language, right?
Yeah. It was in Swedish.
Oh yeah, beautiful.
Steve writes listening to songs, so I just love that when we get scripts, it's in the stage direction. It's what song is playing. Yeah.
Do you know what's a good one, Elliot? When Vanya was being forced acid by the FBI in that Butthole Surfer song. Yeah. That was brilliant.
That was really great.
So I'd never heard that song before. Yeah. So it was the first time I'd heard it.
Renegade. By, is it called Styx?
That's Klaus's drinking montage, right? That's where that is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Good memory, yeah.
It was one of my favorite songs of the show. So, yeah, he's like, I'm letting it go, and that comes on, and you got the camera attached to your body.
Oh, yeah.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
Yeah.
Great moment. It only threw my back out, that rig.
Yeah, they're heavy, aren't
they? Wear one of them?
Yeah.
I think some of the 60s music, too, at the beginning, especially the Bobby Darin, Beyond the Sea, and then My Way, right? What a kind of statement to this family,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
As the world's going up in flames.
My God.
Yeah, that's an epic moment, actually, in the song, yeah.
Rapid fire cue, who is most like their character and who is least like their character?
Aiden's most likely.
Guys, I think we can all agree. Dolores is committed. Like, seriously. She's there.
You're a committed couple.
She's first and last one on set, if I'm being honest. She's always there.
It's tricky to say who's the least because I feel like Steve in the writer's room has started to really write for our strengths and what each of us have started to bring to these characters. So it's really tricky now.
I would say you're not.
Yeah,
like
I said Tom.
Tom would never
eat any of the crap.
Yeah, I wouldn't eat the crap that Luther eats. Yeah, but Steve makes me eat. Yeah, I mean, there's certainly things that I relate to with Luther. You know, he's a little bit slower, I'd like to think, than me at times, or maybe I just hide it better than he does.
I'd agree with that.
We're getting deep. Yeah. We're getting real deep.
Yeah. Yeah. Really? You hide it?
This has become therapy for all of us.
Yeah, I mean, particularly like season one, Luther is much more emotional than I am, let's say that. But I suppose the older brother aspect of it, yeah, I mean, I can relate to that as well, yeah.
I feel like Elliot, you're way happier than Vanya. Vanya's quite sad most of the time.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like I relate to Vanya like from years ago, you know, from certain periods, I suppose, yeah.
When it came to Netflix in 2019, the Umbrella Academy definitely caught viewers' attention, garnered a huge fan base. So when season two was released, there was pretty much no question that it was going to garner even more fanfare. Why do you think audiences reacted so positively to the show and to you all?
I think the seven of us represent seven very different humans and personalities, and all of these characters have like the struggles and the hardships that they go through. And I think in one way or another, someone can relate to at least one of the seven of us very, very strongly. And so I think, but then also pulling a little bit from each of us.
So many people watched it as a family, mm-hmm. you know, mums, dads, mm-hmm. kids, different ages.
Yeah.
But it was also, it was quite current as well, because like the civil rights movement thing, I mean, Black Lives Matter was happening at the same time as the show came out.
We definitely got a lot of reactions to the immediacy of that moment and the storyline that we were telling. And of course, at the time that the series was being written, nobody knew that that was going to happen. So, you know, there's something about the universe taking us to a cool place in season two.
Yeah, I also think there's a level of, like, familiarity, because our show, I think, is very unique. So the first season, you're introducing the world to this new tone, these new characters. A lot of things have to be explained. Season two, I think we were able to just jump right back in and had to waste no time explaining everything because everyone got it already. And so there was that aspect of it, I think, that just grabbed people's attention immediately.
Our series manages to embrace the absurdly comedic and the deeply heartfelt, over-the-top action, comedic elements, musical scenes that we're famous for. What was it like to switch between so many different emotions, and how did that affect how you played your character?
There's times where you feel like you can be comedic in life, and there's times where it will take you immediately into a very heartfelt moment. And that's what, again, is very relatable about this show, is that that's what life is like. You know, you do have ups and downs like that, and it should feel that you easily go through it. And also there's times, you know, when in very serious moments that you find humor as well. You know, you talk to like lots of soldiers and stuff in those scenarios, and that's what I kind of love about our action scenes, is that amongst the madness, there's humor.
I think the funniest moments are when no one thinks that they're gonna be funny. You know, I think very rarely on our show do we read something and say like, oh, I'm gonna make this a joke. I think it's in taking it too seriously that it becomes funnier. Like, Diego has so many moments like that. I don't even think you were trying to be funny for half the things, but they were just hilarious because he took himself so seriously.
That's my philosophy in life. You just take yourself so seriously that...
that it's hilarious.
Yeah. And, well, it's the exposure that we get from, like, everyone that we work with. Like, sometimes you're doing a project where, like, you don't know where you're going, and so it feels really scary. And so this project in itself feels, and it's, you feel like you're not going to be left hanging and being like, oh, is this supposed to be funny? Because I don't know. And that's okay, because the people that are behind the camera are usually the ones that are going to be like, change it here, do this, do that, and just know that it's going to be in the best hands. And I think the editors that edit this thing are probably the ones that can control the pace of, like, how we can get away with being funny and heartfelt and absurd at the same time.
Yeah, the editors do an amazing job. The sound design, all the elements that go into it are pretty extraordinary, and it all adds up to this amazing thing that people obviously love, because so many of our fans feel that kind of close connection to all of you. It's really extraordinary. One last rapid fire, and I promise this one is a rapid fire. What is one non-spoilery word that you can use to describe season 3?
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious?
Yeah,
perhaps.
There it is.
That could work. There's a lot in there to be dissected.
Yeah.
Decode that, and you'll find the answer to season 3.
We're about 2 months into shooting. Is there anything non-spoilery that has surprised you about where the series is headed?
I've enjoyed reading the script so much this year, and also, you know, as we're doing scenes and stuff. And I think it's also because we all know each other so well now, and we know the characters so well, and we know each other's characters so well, that there's a real ease in our scenes with each other, and it's just becoming more and more fun to do. And because the words on the page are great already, you know, so it's just a lot of fun. We were saying this the other day in the scene, weren't we? It's just like it becomes so much fun to do as a group.
And we've got some amazing new cast members that are just bringing a whole different dynamic to play off of, and I think we're really enjoying getting to know the new members of the gang. And I think this is the first season, reading it on paper, that I can't predict where it's going.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, because, you know, we know a little bit going into it from Steve, and kind of he gives us like broad strokes of what happens, but he's been very secretive. But also the twists and turns that this season is already taking on paper, I actually have no idea what's going to happen at the end, which is like, that's the first time being in it and filming, yeah, and kind of not knowing what the end goal is kind of, it's great. I'm here for it.
How could you not come back to see that in season 3?
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody, for being here today. This has been the Umbrella Academy panel for the Academy of Television Arts and Sciences. Thank you for being with us here today. Thank you to the Academy for hearing our message.